In this video, I'm going to use the finite difference time domain method to answer Veritasim's interesting questions.
Imagine you have a giant circuit consisting of a battery, a switch, a light bulb, and two wires which are each 300,000 kilometers long. Now the question is, after I close this switch, how long would it take for the bulb to light up?
According to Veritasium, energy is carried by the electromagnetic field, and the electromagnetic wave propagates out through space to turn on the light bulb. And since the light bulb is only 1 meter away, the time taken is a few nanoseconds. Moreover, it is the field, not the electrons, that carry the energy. Obviously, Veritasium asked about the very basic nature of electricity, and the best way to verify his answer is to use a solution method that solves Maxwell's equations directly. Therefore, I chose the finite difference time domain method, which is the brute force numerical method that calculates the E and the H fields based on Maxwell's equations. The simplest version of the FDTD method calculates the fields in a three-dimensional volume enclosed by a perfect conductor. Lucky me, the basic version is available on the internet, written by Suzanne Hagners. But still, I had to modify the updating equation for the field on the battery, wires, and the light bulb, basically to meet the boundary condition for the perfect conducting wire, as well as solving Maxwell's equations for a load with some finite conductivity. Since the original circuit is in the open space, but the simulation is done in the conductive enclosure, the simulation results for the circuits is very accurate in the beginning, until the waves reflected from the walls add a little bit of ripples on the wires. Nevertheless, the simulation results can still tell us the sequence of events happened in the circuit. During the simulation, the electric field EX on the YZ plane, cutting through the battery and the light bulb, is shown in the top right plot, and EX on the XZ plane of the circuit is shown in the top left plot. The circuit wire is straightened, and the current along the wire is plotted on the bottom left corner, and the voltage across the light bulb as a function of time is shown in the bottom right corner. The volume of space is gridded into 800 by 400 by 400 cubic cells, and each with a side of 0.02 meters. The time step delta t is chosen such that the EM wave takes 2 time steps to travel 1 cell transversely, and delta t is 33.3 picoseconds. With 1 meter gridded into 50 cells, the wave is expected to take 100 time steps to travel 1 meter. If we see this happen in the simulation, then we know that the algorithm is working properly as far as the wave propagation is concerned. In the first simulation, the light bulb is assumed to have a resistance of 100 ohms placed at 1 meter away from the source, and the wires are 5 meters on the left and 5 meters on the right. The battery voltage is normalized to 1 volt, and the rated current is 10 milliamps. When the voltage source is turned on, we see that the wave propagates directly to the load, and it hits the load at the 100th time step. And we confirm that it is spreading at the speed of light. At the same time, the wave also travels along with the wires, going round with the wires, and eventually reach the load at the 520th time step. We see some reflections when the waves turn at the four corners and hits the load. Next, we want to see how the current along the wire and the voltage at the load vary with the wave propagation. In the bottom left plot, we see that the current of about minus 1.5 milliamps propagating out from the battery, spreading to the left and to the right. Note that while one current spreads to the left and the other to the right, they are both negative currents pointing in the negative x direction. Another interesting thing to note is that when the voltage and the current begin the journey from the battery, they do not know what load impedance to expect, and yet they move together with a fixed ratio of about 660 to 1 as governed by Maxwell's equations for the wire. This ratio establishes a characteristic impedance of 660 ohms for the wire. When the wavefront hits the load by the direct path at 3.3 nanoseconds, there is a current induced in the light bulb starting from 0 amps to about 0.2 milliamps DC. and the voltage is built up across the load equal to -0.02 volts. So yes, Veritasium is right. The light bulb is first turned on by the EM wave when it hits the load at 3.3 nanoseconds before the current arrives at the load through the wire. But how long does it take for the light bulb to be fully turned on? To my little surprise, when the current in the wires hits the load, it got reflected back, and the resultant current isn't the rated 10 milliamps. To find out how long it would take the current to reach the rated value, I ran the simulation for another 80 hours, yes, 80 hours, and only to find out that it would take many reflections for the current to reach near the rated value. I subsequently calculated the minimum number of reflections needed for the source to deliver 98% of the rated value, and I got a value of 12, and it is consistent with the results extrapolated from the numerical simulation. So with a 100 ohm light bulb, 300 km wires, and 12.5 reflections, with each reflection taking 2 seconds for a round trip, the minimum time taken to establish 98% of the battery voltage is 25 seconds. Yes, 25 seconds. However, if we choose a load resistance matching the characteristic impedance of the wire, then when the wire current first hits the light bulb, the full voltage is established. In this simulation with a load of 680 ohms, we see the full voltage established when the wire current first hits the load. A natural question to ask is that if the light bulb can be turned on by the EM wave, why do we need the wire in the first place? Can we turn on the light bulb without any wire? So in the next simulation, the light bulb is floating without any wire attached to it. From the simulation, we see that the EM wave does induce a tiny oscillating voltage and current, but eventually subsided to zero. The bottom left plot shows EX along the direct path from the source to the light bulb and it decays rapidly. And the bottom right waveform shows that the light bulb picking up a voltage of 2 millivolts at most. What if the light bulb and the source are connected with wires in parallel, but broken at the two far ends? The simulation shows that the long wire helps to induce more current in the load up to about 0.3 milliamps. The induced currents travel along the wires until they hit the open ends and bounce back. The source currents also bounce back at the open ends and are not able to travel to the load. The induced current is higher than the floating light bulb without wires, but much less than the case where the wires were there to complete the circuit and to deliver the current. Of course, the basic circuit theory can predict the steady state current for the closed circuit, but only Maxwell's equations can predict the induced current for the open circuits. The FDTD method is computationally intensive, so at times I had to split a long simulation into multiple parts so as to check the intermediate results. For example, in this simulation, the simulation stopped at n equal to 201, and only the E field and the H field everywhere in space were safe for the next simulation to continue. I didn't have to save the current along the wire and the voltage across the load, even though these are the two most important circuit parameters for analysis. When the E field and the H field are reloaded into the program, the current along the wire and the voltage across the load are calculated immediately from the E and H, and they turn out to be the continuation of where they stopped in the last simulation. In this sense, the E and the H fields contain all the information about the voltage and the current. So if we can calculate the power absorbed by the light bulb by P is equal to V times I, then it can also be calculated from all the E and H only. After watching Veritasium's video a few times, the main misconception that he wanted to convey was that current did not flow like water in the rubber pipe. It could be induced by the EM wave as well. I totally agree, but I think that this concept should be credited to Maxwell's equations, not Poynting theorem. Once we know that the current can be induced remotely by the field propagation, then as long as the current is induced in the load, the electrons dissipate energy in the load as they lost their potential energy. The concept of current doing work is still valid, and nothing misconception about that. Many YouTubers use the transmission line model to model the circuit, and the shunt capacitors provided the shortcut for the light bulb to turn on immediately. Capacitors in circuit theory allows instantaneous flow of current, and using it to validate Veritasium's point that energy is transferred by field propagation is of course using the wrong tool. They also saw the top and bottom wires forming transmission lines, and the voltage and current propagating between these two lines bounce back at the far ends, acting like short circuits. This is totally different from the simulation, which demonstrated that wires at the far ends are good passages for the current to flow to the load. If we really want to invoke the transmission line model for the sake of calculating current flowing in the wire, then the correct model is that the left and the right wire form the transmission lines, and there are total 3 segments of transmission lines connected in series. They have a little bit of differences in the characteristic impedance, resulted in a little bit of reflections at the corners, but the bulk of the current managed to pass through the lines. The main reflection is actually at the load if it is not properly matched to the line impedance. Of course, there will still be shunt capacitors between the top and the bottom lines, but the main point is voltage and current at the far ends don't get reflected totally because of the short circuits. I really appreciate that you have been bearing with me until now. Cheers, and please click the like button if you can. Thank you.